Welcome to this webinar on software design, software-defined data center design. It's scheduled to be a one-hour session. It's called SDDC design, but the reality of it is that in order to do a software-defined data center design, you're probably going to have to come from one of the couple of traditional data center designs, which I'm going to work through. So if you were on my SDLAN session, or if you've seen the first episode of it on YouTube, that's the approach that we're going to take. So I'll explain, you know, where we've come from, where we're going to, and how we get there, basically, or one of many ways that we can get there. So the technology wise, the software defined data center solution that I'll be talking about specifically will be Cisco ACI is sort of like the end game, but you probably know that there's multiple different options of different vendors, and there's actually multiple different ways to deploy ACI. So what we are going to talk about is Cisco ACI in a multi-site deployment with two data centers, two pods, and multi-site orchestrator, which is the orchestration engine, and we'll talk a lot more about that as we go through the presentation. So just the normal format to introduce myself, I'm not even going to read this slide because you can just pause the video when it's on YouTube, but most of you know who I am. Working in the network industry since about 2003, IT industry since 2003, specializing in networking since about 2007, and worked for multiple different types of organizations, enterprises, service providers, network integrators, things like that. I'm CCDE certified since 2017 and have multiple different certifications from different vendors, including Cisco. So I always like to talk a lot, just briefly about you. We had 63 people register. I don't know how many we've actually, we've got 14 on the call, which is normally 25 to 40% of signups normally turn up, but there may be more trickle in. But of the people who signed up, these are the countries. So thanks for the interest in the webinar from the global audience. And then moving on to the agenda about what we're actually going to talk about. So in this session, I kind of set the scene, so I won't dwell too much on this slide, and we'll just get into the design. Just to set level set with everybody who's on the call, this is design related. So if you're going to start asking me about Cisco ACI endpoint groups and layer three outs and how to configure it, yeah, we might talk about it in a generic term, but it's more thinking about it from a design perspective. And the things that you're going to have to think about as a network designer or a network manager or an IT director, etc., before you decide to go down the software defined route, as it were. So we'll start off by talking, we'll put some diagrams up on the screen. Pretty much the whole presentation is based on diagrams, and I'll whiteboard over the top of it. So we'll talk about, or we'll show an enterprise architectural diagram and highlight the pieces that are relevant to the data center. And we'll move through an evolving story where we'll talk about chassis-based data centers, which was in the introduction video that I done on LinkedIn. That's typically your Nexus and your Catalyst chassis-based switches with big line cards and traditional networking. When I first got into it, that's how data centers were, and we'll talk more about it as we go through. And then we moved into a modular design where it was more kind of core distribution access with dedicated data center type equipment. So that's kind of more when the Nexus range came around, and we had like a spine leaf topology. And this is probably the most common thing that you'll see in place at the moment, but we have a spine leaf topology, but not software defined networking enabled. And that's kind of built that's the building blocks on which software defined data center is built on, because we'll talk more about it when we get into those particular slides, but the spine leaf topology is based around in software defined networking, you're basically only two hops away from another server on the network. But there's a whole other load of things that come along with that, like micro segmentation and things like that as well. So we've only got an hour and just under an hour now. So we'll talk about considerations and things throughout the presentation. So the first four points are kind of like a story, evolving through a story. And the fifth point is going to be throughout the whole scenario or the whole presentation. So if we look on the screen, what we have is, this might be something that a solution architect might provide to you, like not a network architect, a solution architect. And they might say, I've been working on this. We want you to go to a software-defined data center. This is the topology that we want you to implement it based on. And the architectural overview that you see, this would be like a company's full enterprise network. So you see that we have everything in scope here. And the reason that I felt that it was important to show this slide or show this type of design is because even though everything in blue here that I'm circling in purple is effectively what we're immediately concerned with in a software-defined data center, really, but everything that interacts with it at the bottom is impacted by what you do in the data center. So the types of things that we need to think about here, if I just clear the ink off the screen, are things like which data center is active and which data center is standby. So this one might be active and this one might be standby. That then has an impact on which data center do you come in for application access. So do you come in, if you're a remote access user, you might actually come in this way and then go across the back end link and then down to access your applications. If you're on the MPLS, this might be the link with the highest bandwidth, so you might come in that way. And all of these things have a knock-on effect to how your data center is actually designed, configured, and implemented. And that's why I felt it was important to show this slide. So the few different things that we've got here is, like, you might have like a metro area network, you might have an L3VPN network, it might or might not run SD-WAN. And then you have things like, you know, IPsec-based VPN and remote access VPN. So all of these different types of services are coming in towards your data center to effectively access these clouds, which are where you host your applications. And the only other thing just to call out here is we have data center interconnects, which are very important. I've done a session on YouTube on that. So if you go to the MNB Networks YouTube channel, I've covered layer two and layer three data center interconnects already. So we'll touch on it, but we won't spend loads of time on it. So if we move to the next stage then, we move to the next stage and we start talking about the data center evolution. So what we have here is chassis-based design. And this is basically something that I've made up a term for, but it does what it says on the tin, right? So I've got here a picture of basically the largest chassis-based switches that you can buy, which are Nexus 7718, Cisco Nexus 7718. So that's basically 18 slots plus two supervisor cards. So the supervisor cards are these two, which are kind of like adjacent in the middle. So they take up one slot. But the 18 slots in the chassis, they can be basically port density. So in a Nexus, we do have the option, or we used to have the option, to put a Cisco firewall, for example, in one of the physical slots. So we might have like, you'd get different chassis sizes as well. So you get right down to a 7702, and then I think it was a 7706, and then a 7709, 7710, and then a 7718. And that really just depends on what your requirements are and what size organization you have, how many servers you have. Now, we'll come back to the chassis, the slots and stuff in a minute, but you see we also have these switches down here. And these would be referred to as top of rack switches. If I take the pen off for a minute and zoom in a little bit. So, yeah, so top, you see we've got top of rack switches, and they're otherwise now known as leaf nodes. These large chassis based switches, they may or may not have these leaf nodes in the design, because what used to happen pretty much is this could be Nexus or it could be Cisco 6500, which evolved into the 6800. And what you would have with a Cisco 6500 or a 6800 laterally is you would have still have, you never had an 18 slot. I think it went up to 13 slots. So here's a 6 slot. So what you would typically have in a, if this was a 6506, you would have a supervisor and then another slot for another supervisor. And then you might have 24 port popper ports. Then you might have like 12 times 10 gig fiber ports. And that might be like in a very small network. That would be, you might have like 212 10 gig ports, right? And then you would have access layer stacks like throughout your building, which would connect like that, and you would port channel it to 20 gig or whatever. So that's how like a 6500, but with the 6500 and the 6800, what you could also do is put a module. I'll just put services module. And that could be, you know, a content switching module, which was a server load balancer. It could be firewall services module. What else? I can't remember what it was called. There was also basically a module that done like NetFlow. So I'll just call it NetFlow. But it was like an application analytics type module. So, and then if that was like a Cisco 6509 chassis, like that, then that obviously gives you, and then there's 6510 and 6513. So this is the type of design that you used to see in enterprises, and it's probably still quite prevalent out there, because 6500s, they're probably the most solid switch that you could get. They'd never fail. You get line cards and little problems here and there, which is expected, but they're completely solid switches. They're great, but they're now end of life. So it's a similar concept with, that'll disappear now. So it's a similar concept, but the main difference between the 6500 and the Nexus is, and we'll talk about this as we move through the story, is the Nexus ended up getting positioned as a data center switch and a data center switching product line, where the catalyst, all catalyst, including 6500s, 6800s, 3Ks, 2Ks, etc. The 4500s was the other chassis-based switch. And the difference between a 4500, so if this was a 6500, and that could do services module, a 4500, I think that went up to 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You get the picture. So that would be like a 4510, but it might just be 24 copper, 48 copper. So 12 fiber. And the 4500 typically connected to the 6500 or a pair of 6500s in order to provide port capacity. And this was an approach, instead of having redundancy like two switches like you see often at the moment, you would have at the bottom here, you would have like two power supplies going to separate PDUs in the data center, and then the chassis, and then you would have like 2x24 port copper, and then 2x12 port fiber, and then you would have 2x supervisors which failed over almost seamlessly. So this is what I'm talking about from a chassis based perspective. Now if I take the pen off for a second and we zoom into this part here and we start working through some of these things. So I've highlighted some points in blue which are pretty important when we're looking at the chassis based design, because they are still out there, and software defined data center isn't for everyone. It might be out of people's budget, it might be overkill, too many features or whatever. And a chassis like a Nexus 7K chassis or 7706 or something like that might be perfectly adequate for somebody who's got a collapsed core slash a campus core slash server distribution layer. So that might be perfectly acceptable, and they don't need these topper rack switches, for example. More often than not, you see it in some capacity, but you might start off, for example, with a Nexus 7702 with two chassis, so like you see here, but it's only got each chassis, instead of having 18 slots, it might only have one supervisor and one 48-port SFP plus line card in each. So it's a 7702, four slots in total, but two in each chassis. And then to get your scalability, you know, you have downstream, you would connect these downstream topper rack switches to get your port density. It just depends on, you know, what design works best for you. So going back to just terminology-wise, so you've got TOR, which is topper rack, which means you typically have one of these that are circled in red and at the top of every rack, and that's to help from a cabling perspective. So you're only connecting your server or your device to the topper rack switch, and then the topper rack switch has a fiber cable which goes back to the EOR, or the spine in this case, which is EOR being the end of row. So the idea is that you have one of these large or highly high feature switches like a Nexus 7K or a Nexus 5K at the end of row, and then you have, if you've got 10 racks, you would have 10 topper rack switches, for example. You might not need one in every rack because you might only have a couple of devices, so it might be one every two racks, for example. So if we go back here, we'll talk about VDCs, virtual device context, in the next slide. And if we just work through these points, so we have campus core, which can be dedicated or collapsed. So you could have core distribution access in the data center, just like you would have in the campus. VDCs we'll come back to. The servers and the network devices connect to the topper rack switches. And then the second blue point, so some devices may connect to the chassis line card. So instead of connecting to the topper rack switch, you might have certain devices. Actually, I've got one pictured here. For example, a firewall might be better to connect directly to the Nexus or the chassis line card. And the reason for that is if you look at the next point, a FEX can be used or a topper rack switch. And what I mean there is a fabric extender. The concept of this is if you forget about fabric extenders for a second, in the topology that you're looking at, you have Nexus 7K switches and you have topper rack switches. Let's say they are Nexus 5000s, for example, or 6000s, and that's where your servers connect. Nexus 5000s and 6000s are actual switches, so you would need to, in this scenario, you would have a management IP address and responsibility for this switch, and all these switches as separate devices. So you've got 2, 4, 6, 8 devices to manage there as part of your switching infrastructure. If you use fabric extenders, how they are different is if you connect, let's just put one here and then say that's a FEX. And a FEX is just basically ports. But if you connect it, how that looks from a management perspective is that Nexus, it's like slotting a line card in to the physical chassis, but it's actually on the end of a fiber cable instead. But from a management perspective, the FEX will show up as a line card in the chassis. And the 6500s and the 6800s had something similar called instant access. So if we go back to the design points, so they can be FEX or they can be actual switches. We also have virtual port channel, which allows us to aggregate the links. So for example, if we had, let me clear the ink here and ignore the lines that are in place and just pay attention to the red line. If we had 2 uplinks here and 2 uplinks here, virtual port channel allows us to make that a 40 gig uplink. But from a layer 3 perspective, we would still have an IP address here, an IP address here, and like run HSRP. That's just how Nexus works. With the 6500s, it evolved to slightly different, where we have something called VSS. And if this was 2 6500s or 6800s or 4500s, then that's our virtual switching system, and it's one system. And we can still, we can still do this thing and make it a 40 gig, but you would only have one layer 3 interface. So that's why sometimes, although Cisco positioned Nexus in the data center and Catalyst in the campus, that's why some customers still went for Catalyst 6800s and 6500s in the data center, even when Nexus was out. And there's pricing things and feature trade-offs between the two platforms and everything that we could spend all day talking about. But I think it's a bit more interesting if we move ahead with some of the design aspects that we're going to talk about. So I talked about that we can have firewall modules in the slots. This is a similar topology to the software-defined data center spine and leaf, but just without SDN enablement. We'll talk about VDCs in a second, but something that's very important with it is that we need to think about how we design it from a hardware perspective. So I'll explain VDCs, virtual device context, in a second. Before we actually move on to that though, it's probably worth just giving a very, very quick high level. If we've got one Nexus chassis, forget about the line cards. What we can do is split that up to 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, that's not right. I draw it again. If we've got one Nexus chassis, 1, 2, 3. Right. So we can basically split that up into 6 separate switches. And again, like if you have a second Nexus chassis, we can do the same. And what that basically means, this is different from VRFs. So it actually means that we're splitting the Nexus switches up into 8 different separate switches. And how that works is we actually say, right, these hardware resources on Nexus, if this is Nexus switch 1 and this is Nexus switch 2, ports, I don't know, 1 to 4 on line card 1 are in VDC 1. So they cannot be used in any other VDC, so they can't be used in 2, 3, 4. Also, we can go under a VDC, it's like a context in a firewall, and we can reboot. We can reboot and restart VDC 1 without affecting VDC 2 to 8. So the hardware resources are sort of siphoned off between the different VDCs, and it'll become apparent why that would be helpful to organizations when we get onto the next slide. The challenge with it is it can be a bit complicated to manage it and manage the port. So you have to really have your I's and I's dotted and T's crossed in regards to which ports are into which VDCs. There is a question, but I'll come back to the questions at a break point in a second, just because based on past presentations, if I answer them as I go along, it can sometimes, you know, take us off the plan. But I'll come back to that question in a second about the DC firewall. So to round off, I don't think there was anything else to cover on that particular slide. Back-end firewalls, so you've normally got a back-end firewall, which is indicated here in the middle, which might connect to the Nexus. The other thing, just on the fabric extenders, because they're remote line cards, going back to that point, the reason that you might want to connect a firewall directly into the chassis switch rather than a FEX, for example, is because the FEX doesn't have any intelligence. So if you connected a firewall where that server is connected, or any device, in order, and then say there was another device on that network, I'll just draw one in. So if there was another device here, of any kind of device, and this was a FEX, then the traffic flow would have to be up here and back for these, well, let's say it was connected to the same switch, up there and back in order to, you know, to talk to each other. I think that's right. Anyway, there's some sort of, because it's a remote line card, if it's in the same rack, for example, but on a different FEX, it would need to go up and back in order to communicate, which isn't really that efficient in a data center. But they're very cost effective and they provide port capacity. There's also some challenges with connecting firewalls and stateful devices and things like that to FEXs, and you can easily come across problems if you do that. So it just needs careful planning. So moving on to virtual device contexts, I explained what they are, and this is just really a scenario as to what it could look like. And you have to just remember that a virtual device context is effectively like putting another physical appliance into the network. So if you have, I'll go back here, and if I draw, let's say this is a line card, 1, 2, 3, 4, I don't know how many ports are there, right? But let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, right? And this is purposely been drawn like that just to show that it could become quite complex. So let's say we have VDC 1, virtual device context 1, and different line cards. If you select a specific type of line card, you allocate the ports into a VDC based on its ASIC that it's on. So typically, in my experience, most of the line cards are either 4-port or 8-port ASICs. So let's say, for the purposes of this example, it's 4-port ASICs, meaning that blocks of four are in the same ASIC. So if that was the case, then we would say that these four ports are in VDC A, ports 1 to 4 are in VDC 1. Then if we have our VDC A, if we then have VDC B, we might say for some strange reason 13 to 16 are in VDC B. So 13 to 16. And in order for, say, let's say for port 13 to talk to anything in VDC A, then it would need to have a traffic flow like so. It would need to come out of 13 and then go in via 1, 2, 3, or 4 in order to communicate with anything in that VDC. So that's the physical side of it, and this is showing how you might split it up into a data center. So without dwelling on the detail too much in this diagram, what we have here is four VDCs where we have an external VDC. So think of that like internet facing. We have a DMZ VDC, in green. We then have a WAN aggregation VDC, and then we have a data center interconnect VDC. And then you see that we have dynamic routing and BGP, etc., which is running between the different VDCs. So just to be clear as well, so in this part of the network, the red VDCs, we have two devices there. And the reason for it is we have two Nexus chassis and we have effectively two VDCs, and we have to connect those together physically in order for them to talk to each other. So even though logically they're going to be the same VDC, you have to physically connect them together. And the same goes, and that's how you can easily burn too many ports by using virtual device contexts. So if you're ever planning on, for example, doing virtual device contexts with a Nexus 7702 chassis, beware of how many VDCs you're going to need. Because I've done that before, and basically the limit was four VDCs based on a 48-port line card. And then that's when you have to start looking at, you know, expanding your infrastructure. If I clear the annotation here, that's where you have to start thinking about if there was like four VDCs in the Nexus, that's where you have to start, you know, adding these switches down at the bottom to get extra port capacity. Because you might, in that scenario, when I sit in a Nexus 7702 with a line card that you have 48 ports and they're in blocks of 8 in certain line cards, so 6 8s are 48, so you effectively have 6 blocks of 8 ports. So you can see how if you've got one line card, that could be quite tight. So if you had 6 VDCs, you would only have 8 ports per VDC. And that's where you would have to start like saying, well, I need to extend VDC 1 down to, you know, this switch, etc. That's quite an involved design, but it is a common design as well. And the other option, just to be clear, the other option instead of VDCs is you could just deploy additional hardware. So you could have like a Nexus 7702 as your data center switch, and this could be a pair of Cat9Ks. This could be a pair of Cat9Ks. This could be a pair of Cat9Ks, and so could this. In a stack, it's just a different way of delivering hardware redundancy. And I suppose there's pluses and minuses to pros and cons to everything, where the the pro is the fact that you've got one system and you can manage all the different VDCs. And then if you've got highly redundant Cisco 7018, Nexus 7018s with, I don't know, 16 power supplies in it, then you're probably going to be all right in comparison to like having lots of different bits of hardware that you have to manage separately. So that's just some considerations.